Welcome once again to our series on historic Catholic converts. This time we're going across the ocean over to England. And the very famous historian convert, Christopher Dawson, gives us a wonderful quote from one of his books. Actually, it was his book on the history of the Oxford movement that we're quoting from. He gives us a wonderful quote with which to begin this story. This is what Dawson writes. Oxford was the sacred city of Anglicanism, into which nothing common or unclean could enter, where neither popery nor dissent could gain a foothold. It was inefficient, cumbersome, out of date, but it was beautiful. More beautiful, perhaps, than any other place in an England which was still rich in beauty. And consequently, it could still inspire loyalty and affection. Dawson is speaking in that quote of the ancient medieval university city of Oxford. Now, we are in the period of the 1830s. By the 1830s, Oxford University in England had been around for a long time. It had been around for centuries. By the 1830s, the Protestant Reformation was almost 300 years old. So Anglicanism had been around for almost three centuries. Oxford University, quite naturally, was a strong, strong bastion of Anglicanism, of the Church of England. So we have something which is medieval in its historical tradition, and it is the center, has been the center of Anglicanism now for some three centuries. This is the Oxford University to which we will turn, because in the 1830s, something very significant happened at Oxford University, a movement that was going to change a great deal of the religious history of England. What occurred is called the Oxford Movement. Now, to understand the Oxford Movement and what it was all about and what it tried to do, we first of all have to look at a little bit of background. The points of background we have to keep in mind would be three. The first point of background is the French Revolution. French Revolution was probably about 50 years earlier than the period we're at now. The French Revolution was an attack on the church, and it was an attack on the monarchy. Now, you have to understand, people who are in England looking at events going on across the channel over there in France. Well, they're looking with horror. They can't believe what's going on in France. If you were born and raised in England and you were a patriotic Englishman, British patriotism meant absolute loyalty to the monarch and absolute loyalty to the Church of England. The two were absolutely intertwined. Now, here we have a movement in France which is tearing down the church and which is tearing down the monarchy. Well, the British can't believe this. They're looking at events in France with horror. How can these people be so foolish and so stupid? That's the first thing we have to keep in mind. It really reinvigorated the whole idea of national patriotism in England. Loyalty to the monarch, loyalty to the British government. The second point of background we have to keep in mind is this. This patriotism, this strong British patriotism, had a very vital component part to it. And that was a hatred of popery, a hatred of Roman Catholicism, a hatred of everything that was Catholic because it was foreign, and a hatred of everything that was foreign because it was Catholic. It was just ingrained into you if you were born and raised in the England of that time. And the final point of background we have to keep in mind is this. There was in England at this time a very close relationship, a very close union, if you will, between the monarchy and the conservative Tory High Church Party. Now, what do I mean by the High Church Party? I simply mean those political conservatives who were members of the Tory Party who belonged to that element of the Anglican Church we call the High Church. It would be the element of the church which most closely resembled Romanism. They kept all the vestments, and they kept the liturgy, and they kept the doctrines, and they kept the hierarchical structure and so forth. They would be high churchmen. And if you were a Tory and you were a conservative, you were usually a high churchman. Now, the conservative Tory high churchmen enjoyed all kinds of government patronage in England. They were very, very close to the king. This had been going on, as we say, since the reign of George III. And it was a relationship which had been legitimized in much of the writing of political philosophy of those days, and particularly in the writings of the political philosopher Edmund Burke. So that's the kind of England we are living in as we come to the 1830s when the Oxford movement took place. Now, a word about the decade of the 1830s themselves. It was an unusual period in British history. It was a period in which there was an extraordinary flowering of the national genius. Probably there had not been this kind of a flowering of the national genius since Elizabethan times. The 1830s was a decade of poets. It was a decade of men of philosophy. It was a decade of men of strong political action. It was a decade in which England realized she could no longer be provincial, but rather she must move out onto the world scene and take even a greater part in world affairs. So we have now a little bit of background to remember. We have set ourselves in the decade in which the Oxford movement took place. And now we come to Oxford University again, and we ask ourselves, what was this Oxford movement? Well, the movement itself was begun by a number of theologians who taught at Oxford University, men who were teaching philosophy. And if you had to summarize what the Oxford movement was all about and why it was so important to conversions to the Catholic faith, we would summarize it with these two points. The Oxford movement tried to prove the dogmatic authority of the Church of England. In other words, the Oxford movement said that if you trace history, if you go back far enough in history to the time of our Lord and to the commission that our Lord entrusted to Peter and the apostles, that you could trace a direct line from Jesus Christ to Peter, who was the head of the church, through the apostles. You could trace a direct line of apostolic succession right to the 16th century. Then in the 16th century, the church had become so corrupt that the reformers had very justifiably left it, and they continued their own tradition in the Church of England all the way down to the 1830s. Now, this is what the people who were the leaders of the Oxford movement were trying to prove, the dogmatic authority and the direct apostolic succession, which could be traced from Christ through Peter and the apostles down through the Church of England. The problem was, the more they studied it, the more they realized they could not do it. And the more people who studied this proposition very carefully could not reconcile Anglicanism with what they perceived as the truth. And that is why the Oxford movement brought so many converts to Catholicism. Well, that's the first point, the dogmatic authority of the Church of England. The second point for which the Oxford movement was very well remembered was this. The leaders of the Oxford movement did not agree with the idea of the strong union of church and state that we've been talking about. No, they said the church was supernatural. It was removed from natural concerns. It was not a worldly institution. It was divine. It had been founded by Christ, and it must be kept separate from the state. Therefore, we must separate the concepts of church and state. The church cannot be dependent upon the British government. Now, they were the two fundamental components of the Oxford movement. How did these men in Oxford get their views out to the public? How did they influence so many people? How was it that this movement became so well known that so many people came over to the Church of Rome because of it? The Oxford movement got its ideas out to the people through pamphlets, the circulation of pamphlets. Usually, they did not call them pamphlets, however, they called them tracts. And hence, we usually refer to the Oxford movement as tractarianism, because it consisted of tracts, or pamphlets, in which these men expressed their views. The leaders of the Oxford movement, all very prominent in their own time, all very well known in the England of their own time. Of the leaders of the movement, John Henry Newman would be unquestionably the most famous and the most towering figure. Other leaders of the movement are names that, well, unless you've made a study of the Oxford movement, you never would have heard of them. John Keble, Hurrell Froude, E.B. Pusey. Now, most people have not heard those names today unless they made a very serious study. The interesting thing is this. Not one of these leaders of the Oxford movement could have done this themselves. They were all very, very dependent upon one another for the success of the movement. Very likely it could not have been carried out or spearheaded just by any one of them acting individually. Of those four names we mentioned, Keble, Froude, and Pusey, despite their strong Roman leanings, would probably because of loyalty remain Anglicans. John Henry Newman would not remain an Anglican. He would become a Roman Catholic, and he would become the most famous convert of the 19th century. Of the leaders of the movement, John Keble was the oldest. He was the least willing to change in his views. He was one of these stable figures that every single movement needs, and he was a strong influence on all the others. One of the ideas, however, that John Keble could never abide by was this business of church and state being separate. He thought that was a terribly dangerous, dangerous concept. This is what he wrote. "Obedience to rulers and magistrates is, in his judgment, who cannot err, namely God, as sacred a duty as filial obedience. No amount of public or private good would justify a subject in violently resisting authority, except in such an extreme case as would justify a child in violently resisting a father or mother." Well, John Keble, in his turn, strongly influenced Hurrell Froude, who was a much younger man. He influenced Hurrell Froude in much of his philosophical reasoning and thinking and writing. Hurrell Froude conceived of the human mind as having a potential for spiritual vision, and that vision could be realized only by a process of moral steps which would gradually shape the soul into a harmony with the invisible realities of the world of faith. Froude was a magnificent thinker. John Henry Newman said, "I'm the rhetorician, I'm the writer, these men are the philosophers. I will write many of their thoughts." Not that Newman was not a thinker himself, but he was a superb writer. One of his writings, while he was still an Anglican, got him in trouble. He wrote a pamphlet which he called Tract Number 90. Tract Number 90 said, listen, if you take the 39 Articles, now the 39 Articles were the governing body of articles for the Church of England, he said, if you read those 39 Articles objectively and without prejudice, you will find that they are in perfect consistency and harmony with the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. My God, they were astounded at Oxford when Newman wrote this. How can he say such a thing? Newman was preaching at the University Church of St. Mary the Virgin in Oxford, which you can still go and visit today. He was removed from his position as preacher of the University Church because of this dangerous opinion that he came out with in Tract Number 90. He's trying to tell us that the Anglican Church is the same as Roman Catholicism, and it is simply not going to work. So he had to give up his preaching, he had to give up his teaching at Oriel College. He was a fellow at Oriel College at Oxford, and he simply had to retire to the little village of Littlemore, where he was a pastor of the local Anglican Church. It is about a mile or two from Oxford. This movement sounds very intellectual, it sounds very scholarly, it sounds philosophical, it sounds theological, but believe it or not, it had a very practical side to it as well. Professor Owen Chadwick has been a great scholar of the Oxford movement. He writes from a very balanced, very objective, though not from a Catholic point of view. And Professor Owen Chadwick, in one of his books, said, if you are looking for a lot of dogmatic formulas to come out of the Oxford movement, if you're trying to ask the question, well, what philosophy do we get from this? What theology? What doctrinal points? Don't try to do it, says Chadwick. The Oxford movement was actually much more a movement of the heart than it was of the head. It was a way to reform people's spiritual life. It was a way in which people would grow holier. Chadwick writes this, certainly the principal changes which the Oxford movement brought in English life were changes in the mode of worship, changes in the understanding of sanctity, changes in the consequent methods of religious practice, but changes in theological or philosophical thinking were, by contrast, far, far less reaching. So it was a movement in which the leaders saw the Anglican Church had grown spiritually lethargic. They wanted to reinvigorate it. They wanted to spiritualize it. They wanted to make Anglicans more holy. And they did this by trying to, first of all, separate the church from the state, and also by trying to prove the dogmatic authority of the Church of England. They were the two principal component parts. Now, we want to look at three very prominent converts who came into the Catholic faith as a result of the Oxford movement. You could look at hundreds and hundreds of converts who came into the church in England as a result of the Oxford movement, and you could look at a substantial number of converts here in the United States who became Catholics because of the Oxford movement. We want to single out only three, all of them in Britain, and we single out these three because they were very, very conspicuous. The first was William George Ward. William George Ward was the father of Wilfred Ward, and he was the grandfather of Maisie Ward. Now, Maisie Ward married Frank Sheed, and many of you watching this broadcast, if you look in the libraries of your home, you will find old Catholic books published by the publishing house of Sheed and Ward. Well, this is Maisie Ward's grandfather that we're talking about, William George Ward, who came into the church as a result of the Oxford movement. He became a Catholic while he was living at Oxford, and he was a close friend, or became a close friend, of Cardinal Nicholas Wiseman. Cardinal Wiseman said, "Why don't you and your wife move to the vicinity of an old Catholic college now that you are Catholics?" And they agreed, and they decided to do so, and they moved to a vicinity very close to St. Edmund's College in Ware. St. Edmund's College in Ware is today the oldest Catholic college in England. It is the lineal descendant, really, of the famous College of Douay on the continent, where English Catholics had to go to be educated for many, many years during the era of persecution against them, when it was impossible for a Catholic to be educated on the continent of England. So when the laws, the penal laws against Catholics changed, St. Edmund's College at Old Hall Green, near the city, the town of Ware, was the first Catholic college to open. And so today it is the oldest. Well, it was to that little college town that William George Ward and his wife went and settled after they had become Roman Catholics. William George Ward was a brilliant, brilliant intellect himself. He was a rather large man physically. He once wrote about himself, "I have the mind of an archangel in the body of a rhinoceros." Now that would have been an interesting man to see. The mind of an archangel in the body of a rhinoceros. One of his biographers wrote this, "Few more powerful intellects passed through Oxford in his time, and he has justified his university education by his distinction since, both as a Roman Catholic theologian and a professor, and as a profound, profound metaphysical thinker." William George Ward was the founder of the Dublin Review. He began that publication in 1878, and the Dublin Review was fiercely, fiercely loyal to Rome. Certainly among the converts who came in as a result of the Oxford movement, William George Ward would have been one of the most conservative, one of the most right-leaning of the converts. His granddaughter Maisie Ward once wrote this about him. "He would have liked constant and daily guidance from Rome, a papal bull every morning, with his London Times at breakfast." So he was fiercely, fiercely loyal to the Holy See, a brilliant and marvelous convert. The second convert who came into the church as a result of the Oxford movement was Henry Edward Manning. Henry Edward Manning came from a very well-to-do family. He studied at Oxford. After he graduated from Oxford, he entered the Anglican ministry, and as a young Anglican minister, he married, had a wife, and was actively engaged in the Anglican ministry in various churches. He was a rising star in Anglicanism. He became the Dean of Chichester. And after he became Dean of that famous church, he wrote a book which was called The Unity of the Church. He wrote that in 1840. As a result of writing that book, he really confirmed his Anglican credentials and was a rising star in the Church of England. But then he began to read the Oxford tracts, the pamphlets of the Oxford movement. And he became very, very much enamored of the Oxford tracts and where they were going, and he thought that he might go there himself. But he was not ready in 1840. In fact, in 1845, when John Henry Newman became a Catholic, Henry Edward Manning wrote an article rather sharply critical of Newman's desire to convert. Even so, he admitted in his private letters to friends that he found many of the Roman claims very hard to refute. And he did shock the establishment, Manning did, when he did ultimately convert to the Roman Catholic faith. Manning's conversion was not the result of theological or historical research, as John Henry Newman's would be, but rather it was his basic perception of the weakness of the Anglican Church, especially the subservience of the Anglican Church to the government. That is something that he could never abide by. Well, Henry Manning became a Catholic. His wife had died, by the way, some years earlier. So he went eventually and studied for the priesthood, was ordained a Catholic priest, rose very quickly in the church, and he became the Cardinal Archbishop of Westminster, England. Can you imagine that? A former married Anglican clergyman rose to become the Cardinal Archbishop of Westminster. He, throughout his years in Westminster, devoted himself to convert making. One of his closest friends, you know, was Florence Nightingale. Florence Nightingale came very close to becoming a Roman Catholic. She wrote this. She said, "In Germany, they know why they are Protestants. I never knew an Englishman who did. And if he inquires, he becomes a Catholic." We don't know why Florence Nightingale herself never became a Catholic. She was very close. She served in the Crimean War. God knows why, but she was terribly, terribly close. She did not, but she always expressed a desire to want to become a Roman Catholic. And our final convert today that we want to talk about from the Oxford movement is a gentleman by the name of Frederick William Faber. Frederick William Faber was born in 1814. He was the son of an Anglican minister in Yorkshire. He went to Oxford, he listened to Newman preach in the University Church in Oxford, and he very quickly became a Newmanite. He entered the Anglican ministry, he was assigned to a church in Elton, and in 1844, Faber wrote these words to Newman. He said, "I seem to grow more Roman daily, and almost to write from out of the bosom of the Roman Church instead of from where I am. I suppose I am not going on as I ought to do, for our system seems to me more and more to enervate me, to bring me down, and I sometimes get a glimpse of a state of mind which would view my position as a parish priest as that of a man telling a lie to his people." He could no longer stay a parish Anglican priest. So he decided, Frederick William Faber, that he must become a Catholic as well. He was a great friend of the poet William Wordsworth. Wordsworth wrote to him and he said, "I'm not going to tell you that what you were doing is wrong, but England is losing a poet." Well, Wordsworth was wrong. England was not losing a poet. Frederick William Faber became a Roman Catholic priest. He became an Oratorian of the Congregation of the Oratory founded by St. Philip Neri. He was the founder of that magnificent Brompton Oratory in London, in the Knightsbridge section of London, so close to the famous department store of Harrods, one of the great, great Roman churches in the city of London. And as a Roman Catholic, Frederick William Faber became a tremendously popular devotional writer. He wrote All for Jesus. He wrote Growth and Holiness. He wrote The Creator and the Creature, The Foot of the Cross, and The Precious Blood. And he was a great writer of Catholic hymns. I suppose one of the best known, if not the best known, was The Faith of Our Fathers, written by Father Faber of the Oratory. Such then were typical Oxford movement converts: William George Ward, Henry Edward Manning, Frederick William Faber. Many historians would give the Oxford movement a lifespan of about a dozen years, and certainly in natural terms, a lot of things took over which would have precluded what the Oxford movement was all about. But from the perspective of the faith, my friends, from the perspective of the Catholic faith and bringing converts to the Catholic faith, the Oxford movement was a movement of very, very enormous consequence, both in England and here in the United States. It attracted very significant converts in both places. Surely, one of its greatest claims to fame was that one of its leaders, both as an Anglican and a Catholic, was the most towering intellect of the 19th century. His name was John Henry Newman, and it is him to whom we will turn in our next broadcast.